Hi everybody, Joey here again, and welcome back to part two of the office aquarium build. Now last week we built the actual aquarium, this week we're building the filtration for it. Now just to bring you up to speed, the aquarium itself is 6 feet long, 1 foot wide, 1 foot tall, and we built it out of 3/4 inch cell cast acrylic. That acrylic was actually leftover material from the 375 gallon build. So we basically built that aquarium out of scrap acrylic. But hey, I'm not one to waste, and we got a really cool aquarium out of it. Now, as mentioned in the previous video, this aquarium posed a number of challenges. We're now faced with the challenge of the actual stand that this is going to go in. Now, this will make entirely more sense next week when I show you how I built the stand. What I had to do was build an internal filter. I chose to go with an internal filter for a number of reasons. Number one being that it's an all-in-one aquarium, meaning that all of the filtration, the heating, circulation, everything is built directly into the aquarium. Which means I can essentially put this tank wherever I want as long as I have something that can hold it. And given that this is a relatively small tank, having an external filter doesn't really make a lot of sense, and of course a sump wouldn't be entirely all too practical. Although if that's something you want to do, go ahead. But for something like this, I prefer an internal filter. But I didn't want a filter that would really take away from the aquascape, because we will be scaping this tank and creating a bit of a biotype. So I wanted something that would blend into the tank and wouldn't take your attention. An all-in-one tank is the perfect solution for this. In order to build it, I went back to using some black acrylic that I had previously. You guys will remember that I originally bought a full sheet of this so I could do a number of things with this aquarium. We built a weir out of it, we built a controller box, we used it for baffles, and now we're going to build an internal filter for this tank. Mind you, I still have lots left, and that's kind of the benefit to buying a full sheet of acrylic or a full sheet of supplies, is that you're going to most likely have a lot more than you need. And you might not think that you'll use the materials for future projects, but it always comes in handy. The downside is that you buy a lot more than you need up front. However, in the long run, you save a lot more money. Now I wanted this filter to actually go on one end of the tank. Now since it is a 6 foot long tank, I figured I could afford to sacrifice about 6 inches of the length. Which in the grand scheme of things, once you see the tank set up with the filter in it, it's not that bad at all. I did want to keep this relatively simple. I only needed the filter to do 3 things for me. One is obviously filter the water, both mechanically as well as biologically. I also need to fit a heater behind it, plus a return pump. Which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're working with a little bit of space, you have to get pretty creative with it. Now, I've shown you guys how to build all different types of internal filters in the past, and this one really isn't going to be much different. The principles are all really the same. You want to start off, obviously, with the front panel, making sure that it's the width of the tank. And then, depending on how you want to set up the filter behind it, depicts how many of the baffles in behind you'll need. I'm only going with 2, and this is going to be really simple to make. I first played around with the placement of the panels and made sure that it could not only fit what I needed to, but the placement was proper, and then I marked off where I wanted the overflow to go. The overflow or the teeth were cut out typically how I always do, which is on a table saw. I basically clamp a piece of wood on the table saw, and this stops the acrylic from moving too far. As I push the acrylic onto the blade, the wood stops it and sets the depth each one of these gaps will be. Now, if you didn't watch my video on how to build an aquarium weir, I went into specifics on how to make one of these and how to size the teeth and the gapping. Basically going over the flow rates. Now, I knew going into this, I would only need this to handle between 200 and 260 gallons per hour. However, this tank is actually going to house some pretty small fish that will most likely breed in this tank and have fry, so I had to keep the gaps and the teeth pretty small. I made each gap about 1/4 inch wide and about 1.5 inches tall. Each one giving me a maximum flow rate of about 30 gallons per hour, which is twice as much as I need. Once I cut the teeth out, I drilled a small hole in the same panel where the return pump would return water to the tank. Now with the other baffles, I basically did the same thing except made those gaps much larger. No fish are going to be behind this, and I wanted to make sure there was no possibility of any clogging, so I just made them pretty big. Obviously being able to handle several times the flow that I had planned to put through it. Then I cemented them in place with Weldon 16. Now Weldon 16 is a thicker acrylic cement, but for something like this, I tend to prefer it. Then I let it cure overnight. Now before installing the filter into the aquarium, I removed all of the protective paper first. Now typically I would only remove the inside as the filter is going on the inside, and I wouldn't remove the outside protective tape until the aquarium is actually in place just to protect it from scratches from me moving it around. But so we could get a proper view, I removed all of it. Now, putting this in place, I didn't cement it in place. And you might think that why wouldn't you cement acrylic to acrylic? And the reason is simple. I decided to silicone it so it wouldn't be a permanent fixture. You see, if I ever decide to do something different with this aquarium or change it eventually, I'm not completely stuck with this type of filtration. Not that it's bad, it's just that I might change my mind down the road sometime. Silicone will hold the acrylic firmly in place, and it's not going to come off anytime soon, and of course it's going to be waterproof. Plus, it's not going to be under any pressure, so siliconing acrylic to acrylic is completely fine. However, you can't build an aquarium out of that because the pressure will just blow it apart. I then waited for the silicone to cure, and then I was able to move on to the next step. Now, to give you a basic idea of how this is set up, the first baffle where the teeth are has an area of 6 inches long, 6 inches wide, and 12 inches deep. A capacity of about 7 liters. This is going to be my mechanical filtration and biological filtration department. The middle section is only 2 inches wide and is just big enough to slide a heater into place. I don't need a large area for the heater, but the purpose of having it there is so that after the water flows through the biological filtration compartment, it is forced to go up past the heater, so that the water is evenly heated, which makes the heating even more efficient. The last compartment obviously just fits the return pump, and that was 4 inches wide. We'll come back in a minute to how we installed the pump and all of the media and explain exactly how this is going to work. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I did a video on yet another alternative to an aquarium background, and I showed you how you can use window tint and window frosting as aquarium backgrounds. And this tank actually got a window tint. I showed you how to apply it and all the details to it. But one thing that you'll notice that is that instead of leaving the filter exposed on the side, I made sure I tinted that as well. Now, under normal circumstances, you can't see through the tint. However, if I shine a flashlight through it, I still can, which is beneficial so I could check in on the filter if I ever need to. With most of the filter completed and the background installed, I could now go ahead with finishing up the filter. We'll start with the pump compartment. This would be the return. I went with an Eheim Compact 1000. I went with it for a number of reasons. They're pretty affordable, they are compact, and they are silent. Plus, they have a little adjuster on it so I can adjust the flow up and down. And I know that this pump works well with half-inch CPVC, which is what I was going to use for the return pipe. For the return pipe, I cut some of that CPVC pipe up and attached it to the pump with a little bit of spare hose. On the top, attached a 90-degree elbow and ran a little bit more of the CPVC pipe. On the other side, a couple of more elbows, and that would act as my return. I didn't cement any of this together, simply because the water pressure is not going to be able to blow it apart, and I wanted to be able to adjust the output of the direction of the water flow. The pump is rated at about 260 gallons per hour. The tank being only 45 gallons means that I'll be able to turn the entire tank's volume over in the filter about 5 times per hour, which is ideal for a filter like this. As for the heating compartment, well, only being 45 gallons, I didn't really need a large heater. However, given its dimensions, it does have a pretty decent footprint, which means it's going to lose heat a lot faster than a more compact size. And finding a small reliable heater that's less than 12 inches tall, that's about 200 watts, isn't as easy as I thought it was going to be. But I did come across a 200 watt Aquatop titanium heater, and it has a built-in controller. Which means it will monitor the temperature of the aquarium, turn the heater on and off as I set it to. This fit in perfectly into the heater compartment as well. Now, I'm not familiar with this brand and it's the first time I bought it, but I have used plenty of titanium heaters in the past and they are really reliable. Now I was ready to move on to the actual filtration portion. Now, given that the water is going to flow down through this and underneath, I couldn't have the media sitting at the bottom of this compartment, so I rigged up a lighting diffuser stand with some zip ties. This was going to provide me with a pretty sturdy stand for the media to set on while keeping the flow away completely free of any media. Now for me, I always have a mesh bag of cycled media in a sump or in an aquarium somewhere. And that's what I was going to use to put into this aquarium so I could essentially start off with a fully cycled filter right away. Now at this point of the build, I didn't actually set the tank up and get it running. So the biological media stayed in the sump, just so I didn't kill the bacteria. But you'll see it all get added later on in the series. As for mechanical filtration, I cut to size a couple of sponges. And these will sit directly on top of the biological media. I started off with two sponges because I wasn't sure how much media I was going to be able to fit in there, and I ended up only using one sponge in the long run. Now, the way this is going to work is simple. I'll fill the tank up, and as the pump turns on, it's going to start sucking water from the other compartments and pushing that water back into the main aquarium. As that water is pushed to the main aquarium, that water will overflow into the first compartment and be mechanically filtered by that sponge. The water then travels down through the biological media, removing ammonia and nitrite, serving its biological function, followed by flowing under the next baffle and up through the heating compartment, evenly heating the water, finally overflowing into where the pump is, and the pump again pumps water back to the main aquarium. And this is a continuous cycle. The main benefits to a filter like this is obvious. It's an all-in-one filter, you don't have to worry about anything external. It doesn't take up much space, and it acts almost like a sump. Everything is visually not in the aquarium, and you still get surface skimming of the water, which aids greatly in gas exchange and removing any surface film like protein buildup. Now I just have to build the stand, install the aquarium, and get the filter up and running, fill the aquarium up, scape it, stock it, and enjoy it. Anyways, I hope that you guys enjoyed today's video. I also wanted to thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next Sunday for part 3 of the office tank build.